So the next lecture in power system that we are going to take is transformers. So first we will discuss the single phase transformer, then we will discuss the auto transformer, and then we will go for three phase transformer. So before we start with the theory of the transformer, let us look back in the history, like how transformer has come and what led to its invention. So the question, first question that is being asked, that who invented the transformer? So if you see that there is a gradual and slow and steady process by which each scientist has given their own contribution till a practical power transformer has come and that has been installed. So the contribution given by many scientists in the invention of the transformer, there are a lot of names that you can find out here. So Otto Velasky, Mixara Adeiri, Carlodi, Zippert Noski, they were the first to design, and later on other few scientists were there, researchers were there who has perfected the design, that is Lucien Gollard, Sebastian Ferranti and William Stanley. So there is a slow and steady process. So in the picture you can see that in 1885, William Stanley first built a transformer which is single phase AC transformer, and it is very small in size. So this was in 1885, and in 1886, if you see, then the Stanley first transformer was used in the electrification in the Great Barrington, Massachusetts in 1886. So the next question came, that when was the transformer invented? So since the, as I said, that the working on the transformer, a lot of scientists were playing their own role. So if we come up with a particular year, like when the transformer was invented, then we can say that in 1886, William Stanley built the first reliable commercial transformer. So the year 1886 will be remembered as the invention of the transformer by William Stanley. So when was the first transformer used? The next question that can become like, so it was in Great Barrington. So here we can see the picture in Massachusetts in 1886, when William Stanley presented the first commercial transformer. And then in 1891, Dobrsky designed and demonstrated his three-phase transformer in Frankfurt, Germany. So you can see the trend by which the transformer came and how the transformer was invented by single phase in single phase and three phase transformer mode, and who were the scientists involved. So a famous fight between the AC and DC, you can know that it was between Michael Faraday and Nikola Tesla. So before we see a little bit introduction about the two, like what the role these scientists were playing. So Michael Faraday was the first to give the principle of electromagnetic induction in the year 1831. So it was in 1831 when Faraday gave the principle of electromagnetic induction. And then the finding forms on the basis of magneto-electrical machines. So Faraday, who gave electromagnetic induction in 1831, were the basic principle being used by most of the electrical machines. Then the earliest use of the phenomena was in the development of the induction coils. So this electromagnetic induction principle was first used in the development of the induction coils, and then these coils were used to generate high voltage pulse to ignite the explosive charges in the machine. So where the induction coils were used? It was used in the mines to ignite the explosive charges. So Nikola Tesla and Edison, these were the two scientists who contributed in their own part in the AC and DC supply, where the DC power system was used in a particular time for a long period of time, where Edison was basically involved in the DC system. Then there were some limitations which were found in the DC system that led to the invention of AC, and many practical electrical machines were using the AC supply, which was basically given by Nikola Tesla. So the limitations of the DC, if you see the two limitations, one for economic transmission of power, the generating station and the load center have to be necessarily close to each other. So if you are producing electricity in DC mode, then the generating station has to be very near to the load center, because electricity can't be transmitted over a long distance when we use for a DC generator. So DC generator cannot be scaled up due to the limitation of the commutator. So even if you want to increase the level of the voltage, then the DC generator were not capable to scale up the level of the voltage due to the use of commutator, because there is a commutator which will restrict the maximum level of the voltage that the DC generator would produce. Therefore, the world looked for other efficient method of bulk power generation and transmission. So when these limitations of DC come, people have known, then the world was looking for a most efficient method of the energy generation as well as transmission. Then in the second half of the 19th century, the alternators, transformers and induction motors were invented. So you can see that in the 19th century second half, most of the AC machines like alternators, transformers and induction motors were invented, which play a very crucial role in generation and the transmission of electricity in the form of AC. These machines are basically working on the alternating power supply. So whether it is an alternator, transformer or induction machine, they basically work in the AC power supply. So with the invention of transformer, now the transformer plays a very important role. It was possible to choose a moderate voltage for generation of AC power. Now you choose a moderate voltage, what for? The generation. And then a high voltage for transmission over a long distance. And finally use a small and safe operating voltage at the user end. So the invention of the AC machines like alternators, transformers and induction motors have played an important role, and among them the transformer is a very vital instrument. Now why it is a vital? Because you can produce electricity with the help of an alternator at a moderate voltage, then you can transmit the electricity with the help of a transformer at a very high voltage, and then at the user end, you can use the electricity at the safe operating voltage. So transformer play a very important role in stepping up of the voltage and stepping down of the voltage. So here we will just look an introduction of a transformer and how it plays an important role in the modern power system. So we say that transformer is basically the heart of the AC system. So any system heart you can consider to be a transformer. So here a photo of a transformer has been given, which is a very big transformer, and this is a transformer which is kept in the substation, so it can be a distribution transformer. Now if you look a power system, so power system will include generation, transmission and distribution, and then it will include utilization. So the generation of electrical energy which is taking place in the power plant is located very far away distance from the consumer, which is a load center. So this distance length between the generating end, which is the power plant, and the consumer end is very large. This long distance transmission of electric power would not have been possible if you have been gone for a DC power supply. But for AC power supply, what happened is that the electrical energy which is produced in AC at a particular moderate level of the voltage is stepped up with the help of a transformer, which is the step up transformer. So you can see that electricity can be produced at a voltage of 11 kV or 12 kV. You can see we take 11 kV voltage. So 11 kV voltage, which is produced at the generating station in the power plant, with the help of a step up transformer, the electricity is stepped up at a very high voltage of 240 kV. So 240 kV electricity, which is stepped up from the generating station using a step up transformer, now can be transmitted over a long distance, because when the level of the voltage increases, the loss decreases. So the energy loss will decrease because the level of the voltage has increased. Now with the use of transmission conductor, you can transmit the electricity, and near to the consumer end, there will be a step down transformer. This step down transformer will bring back the voltage to a lower level of the voltage, which can be in the range of 3366 kV. And this step down transformer in the substation will then transmit the power to the different consumers. These consumers can be industries, or these consumers can be household appliances. So the household will take the electricity in single phase. The industries will take in three phase. So the industries will take electrical energy in three phase at a high voltage of 440 volt or even high voltage. And at the household appliances will be operating on single phase, which is 230 volt. So this is the entire power system where the electrical energy is transmitted from the generating end to the utilization end. And the transformer connected at the two end plays a very important role, that is a step up transformer and step down transformer. Now, in day-to-day life, when we are going to study the electrical power transformer, we will be using this construction. So basically, this rectangular section will be used as the core. So this is your core, which is made up of some material, but we will be taking here iron core. Now you have primary turns, which is connected to the supply. The supply is AC. This is known as the primary voltage and the primary current and the primary turns. So all the items which are connected, or the terms which we'll be using on the primary side, are known as, are connected to the primary winding. Whereas the secondary winding is connected to the load end. So since this transformer is single phase, the load will also be single phase, right? So the load is connected with the help of secondary winding, which is having a NS number of turns. VS is the load voltage or the secondary voltage, and IS is the load current. So this particular circuit we will be using every time to understand the principle of the transformer. So let us look into an introduction of the transformer. So the first point, transformer is a static device. So transformer is a static device means there is no rotating part. So you do not have any friction losses. So there is no point of having friction losses because the transformer is a static piece of apparatus. Second point is, change in the voltage and current are labels keeping the power invariant. So basically you will be keeping the power constant. So we are not going to change the level of the power. Only thing is that we are going to change the voltage and the current. So by changing the voltage and the current, keeping the power constant, we are going to step up or step down the voltage. So once you are changing the voltage, correspondingly current will change. So this is the second point. Third point is, it consists of two electrical circuits linked by a common magnetic circuit. Now you understand here, the magnetic circuit is common, which is linking the primary circuit and the secondary circuit. So primary circuit and the secondary circuit are basically two circuit which are basically electrical in nature, and they are linked with a common magnetic circuit. So there is no physical connection between the primary circuit and the secondary circuit. So one of the electrical coil is used for the generation of a time varying magnetic field. So the flux that is set up in the core of a transformer is basically AC in nature, that is alternating, time varying. So the primary winding which is connected with the supply is basically producing a flux which is alternating in nature in the core, and that flux is linking with the secondary coil through the common magnetic circuit. Now the second coil which is linking the magnetic field has induced voltage in it. So electromagnetic induction will be here which will come into picture. So it is a magnetic induction. So second coil, that is the secondary coil, is linking with the magnetic field which is produced by the voltage in the primary circuit, and it will be inducing a voltage in the secondary coil. The magnitude of the induced EMF is decided by the number of turns in the coil. So we have understood that E is equal to N d phi by dt. So from Faraday's law, we know that induced EMF is proportional to the number of turns. So the number of turns in the winding play a very important role in deciding the magnitude of the induced EMF. So magnitude of the induced EMF is decided by the number of turns. Then the voltage level can be changed by changing the number of turns. So if you change the number of the turns, obviously you can change the induced EMF on the voltage level. So the winding, primary winding, is basically connected to the supply or the voltage source. Hence, it is known as the excitation winding. The secondary winding is connected to the load. Hence, it is known as the output winding. So the winding which is connected to the source will be the primary winding. The winding which is connected to the load is known as the secondary winding. Next point, no conductive connection between the two electric circuits, and thus provide electrical isolation. So between the primary circuit and secondary circuit, you have a magnetic circuit, which is the iron core, and the two coils, which are electrical, are not conductively coupled. So there is no conductive connection between the two coils. So basically there is an electrical isolation between the two windings. Now we keep the power constant in supplying the voltage and the current, and also the frequency on the two sides will be the same. So in a transformer, when you supply 50 Hz on the primary side, that is the supply voltage, on the load also you will be getting 50 Hz. So the frequency of the supply as well as the load frequency will remain the constant. So if you measure the current or the voltage at the load, its frequency will be also same as the supply voltage. Efficiency of the conversion is extremely high. So transformer is the most efficient apparatus in electrical machine. Its efficiency is close to 98% to 99%. So the efficiency of the transformer is quite high because the leakage is less. There will be very less leakage in the transformer winding, and the friction losses will be zero because it is a static piece of apparatus. Hence, its efficiency will be extremely high. So there is no change in the nature of power. So as I said, the power will remain constant. So the term transformer is used and not converter. So we are not using it as a converter. So basically, the voltage which you are giving at the primary circuit and the voltage which you are getting in the secondary circuit has a change in the level of the magnitude of the primary voltage and the secondary voltage. So there is a change in the magnitude. So that is the reason it is known as a transformer but not the converter. If you give an AC supply and get a DC supply at the output, then it is a converter. It is known as the rectifier, right? So here, transformer is not a converter. Rather, transformer is the change of the level of the voltage. Now, transformers are not limited to power system. So it is not like that we will be using the transformer only in the power system. Its frequency is operating from few hertz to several megahertz. So if you see the construction of the transformer used in different application, you can get a transformer from the few hertz to several megahertz, and this several megahertz transformer is basically used in the communication system. So in the communication system, you will be using a transformer, very high frequency transformer, and in the power transformer, you will be using at a frequency of 50 hertz or 60 hertz. So that is the reason it is told that transformer is used from few hertz to several megahertz. Power rating from few milliwatt to several hundred of megawatt. So you can see the level of the change of the power. A transformer can be in the range of milliwatt to in the range of megawatt. So there is a very small transformer as well as very big transformer. So electric power generation demand doubles every decade in a developing country. So this is the note point why the transformer is coming into picture. So for any developing country like India, if you see, the electric power generation is double every decade. So every 10 years, if you see the trend, the electric power generation demand is increasing. For every MVA of generation, the installed capacity of transformer grows by about 7 MVA. So if you want to produce a power of 1 MVA, the installed capacity of transformer grows about 7 MVA. So 7 times you can see the power requirement of the transformer is increasing. And in 10 years, that is one decade, the generation will be doubling. Now, we will see a little bit of the construction of the transformer. So the construction of the transformer differs because of the end use. So how the transformer is used, depending upon it, the construction of the transformer will vary. So the construction of the transformer will vary depending upon the use for which it is done. So apart from use in power system, special transformers are used in application like electronic supplies, rectification, furnaces, traction. So transformer construction is differing because of the use. So where is the use? Either in the power system or any electronic appliances, rectification, furnaces and traction. So there are different application of the transformer and its construction will differ based on the use or application. However, the principle of operation remains the same. So whether you are using a transformer for traction purpose or you are using a transformer for power system or furnaces, the principle of operation remains the same. So if you understand the principle of a transformer, operating principle of a transformer, that particular transformer can be applied to any applications. So in our discussion in electrical machine, our focus will be on power transformer only. We will be not discussing anything regarding the electronic supplies or rectification or furnace or any other applications. Our discussion will focus on power transformer because that is a part of the electrical machines in electrical engineering. So the constructional aspects will be discussed under the three categories. So we are discussing the construction of the transformer. So these particular three things we will be focusing for a power transformer. One is core construction, second is winding arrangement, and third is the cooling aspect. So how the construction of the core is there, how the winding are arranged, and how do transformers cool down. So let us first look the core construction. So we have already learned the magnetic circuit chapter first. So that will be used very much in the core construction. So the material which is used to make the core of a transformer should be highly permeable. So mu R value should be very greater than 1000. So material which are highly permeable are used for making the core of the transformer. Why we required highly permeable material? So highly permeable material will give the low reluctance path to the flux. Now any material whose permeability is quite high, it will be giving the low reluctance to the path of the flux in the core. So we required the flux to be easily established in the core of the transformer. So the mu R value of the core material of the transformer has to be very high. So it can be in the range greater than 1000. Flux lines will confine to the core. So here we are generally writing iron. However, the transformer material is made up of different from that of iron. However, we are just specifying it is an iron core. So flux lines will be confined to the iron core. We want the flux lines to be in the core and not in the air. So that is the leakage flux. So we want the flux lines to be in the core. Silicon steel in the form of thin laminations is used. So here, as I said, that iron is not used to make a core. Rather, we are going for different varieties of silicon steel. So silicon steel is the material which is used to make the core of a transformer. However, there are different types of silicon steel, so that we will see. So over the years, for better magnetic properties, hot rolled non-oriented to hot rolled grain oriented steel is used. So this is how the core of the transformer is constructed. So basically the silicon steel is used to make the core, and we are moving from some process which is known as hot rolled to basically grain oriented steel. And in this regard, I would like to say that CRGOS, that is the cold rolled grain oriented silicon steel, is basically used to make the core of the transformer. So if we are going to be very specific in what material the core is made up of, we don't say it is made up of iron. It is basically made up of silicon steel, but the correct name for which the core is made is CRGOS, that is the cold rolled grain oriented silicon steel. The thickness of the laminations progressively got reduced for over 0.5 mm to present 0.25 mm per lamination. So we have seen that the losses in many magnetic circuit is because of hysteresis and eddy current loss, and it can be minimized if we give laminations. So eddy current loss can be minimized if the laminations are done. So we have discussed this in the first chapter. So over the years, from 0.5 mm to 0.25 mm, the lamination thickness is continuously decreasing. So the laminations will be in this fashion to make the core of the transformer. So the core of the transformer will not be a thick material. It is not a solid one. Rather, it is made up of laminations. And these laminations are coated with a thin layer of insulating varnish, oxide or phosphate. So when you are making the laminated core, it is insulated also with the use of varnish, oxide or phosphate. Now, this core, which is made up of some magnetic material, has some property. It should have high permeability. So mu value has to be very high, which we have discussed it should be more than 1000. Its saturation flux density should be high. Now, why we require saturation flux density to be high? Because if you remember, we have drawn the hysteresis curve like this. So this is your saturation flux density. So if it is more high, obviously more current it can draw to produce the flux. So the saturation flux density has to be high, permeability has to be high. And the area under the BH curve, which is representing the losses in the magnetic circuit, should be less because it permits high flux density of operation with low magnetizing current and low hysteresis loss. So this area, which is under the BH curve, has to be low so that the losses is less in the hysteresis and less current it draw to produce the flux. Now, the resistivity of the iron sheet itself is required to high to reduce the eddy current loss. So you know that eddy current loss can be minimized if the core is laminated and we want the resistance to be high so that current is reduced. So R is equal to rho L by A that we have discussed. So we want to reduce the resistance so that high current is required to produce the resistance will be high so the less current is there in the core so that eddy current is less. Now if you want to increase the resistance, obviously the area under the cross section has to reduce. So this area under the cross section is reduced with the help of laminations, and the resistivity of the material is high. So if the resistivity of the material is high, obviously the resistance will be high. So if the resistance is high, then only the current, that is the eddy current, will be less. So that is the reason eddy current itself is highly reduced by making the laminations very thin, because we want to have the decrease in the area. So if you decrease the area with the help of laminations, it is good to reduce the eddy current. And lamination is made up too thin, then the production cost of steel lamination increases. Now, if you keep on decreasing the laminations quite thin, then the cost of the steel lamination will increase. And for a very small transformer, which you are using in the laboratory, like few volt ampere or few kVA, hot rolled silicon steel laminations in the form of the core construction can be E&I, C&I and O. So here you can see that it is in the form of E core, you can see. So here you can have in the form of IC. So this is your core, which is in the form of I or C, and you can have O type of laminations. So basically the cores are laminated to reduce the eddy current, and the core construction should be in such a way that the area should be less by laminations and the resistivity of the material has to be high. Now the silicon content in the steel is 3.5%. So you know that we are using a material known as CRGOS to make the core of the material. So the silicon content in this steel is 3.5%. Above this, steel become very brittle and also very hard to cut. So we should not cross the limit of 3.5%. And the saturation flux density of the present steel lamination is about 2%. So the BH curve that we know, so here we require the saturation flux density. So this is your Bmax, that is the saturation flux density. So steel lamination, it is about 2%. Now we will discuss the core type transformer. So core can be again of various types. So first type we will discuss the core type transformer. So here we can see that any single phase transformer, which is a 2-leg core, 3-leg core and 4-leg core. So this is your leg of the transformer. So you can have either 2-leg. So if you are having 2-leg of a transformer, like this is the first leg and this is the second leg, here your winding is there. So this is the 2-leg single phase transformer core. If you have one more leg at the center and the windings are not placed at the extreme end, rather the windings are placed here, then it is a 3-leg core where the winding is in the center. and this is a four leg core where at the two end the windings are on and at the end there is no winding. And now here one point has to remember is that when we study any transformer, we just draw the transformer in this fashion, where we show the primary winding is here and the secondary winding is here. However, in practical case, the primary winding and the secondary winding, which is again can be defined as low voltage winding and high voltage winding, will not be this much distance apart. This is only for the theoretical purpose, but practically or in generally, the winding will be located like if you have the core here, then first the low voltage winding will be owned on the core and then you will be having the high voltage winding. So high voltage winding will be owned concentrically from the low voltage windings. First the low voltage winding will be there, which is near the core, and then the high voltage winding will be there. So here you can see that first you are having a low voltage winding which is near to the core, and then you are having a high voltage winding which is far from the core. But both low voltage winding and high voltage winding are on the same leg of the transformer. It is not like that what we draw in the theory, that it is in the two leg which is very far from each other. This is only for study purpose, where to understand the transformer action. And there will be insulation between the low voltage winding and the high voltage winding. And also, if you see the top end of the transformer, you will find that the core, this is your core of the transformer, which is basically laminated to reduce the area so that the resistance is increasing, and the winding, which will be in the form of concentric cylinder. So winding is in the form of a concentric cylinder, where low voltage winding is near the core and high voltage winding is away from the core, but both are concentrically placed. So in the core type construction, the winding is surrounding the core. So we will be discussing the construction of the core at two terms. One is core type and other is cell type. So there are two type of core we will be discussing first. So the core type of transformer, you will be having the winding which is surrounding the core. So this is your core and winding is surrounding the core. So this is the core type transformer. So in the next lecture, we will discuss the cell type of transformer. So till here, we will be focusing our discussion for today. Next lecture, we'll discuss the cell type transformer and continue the discussion.